101.5 KGBFM San Diego. It's the best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. It's Boyer with you on a Saturday morning between now and straight up 12 noon, playing back some of the best stuff that we have done all this past week. Hang out for a couple of hours on the show. You will hear, honey, we've got some plumbing problems, and guess what? They are personal. Abramowitz takes another Thursday golf bet. The one he said he wouldn't take. Did he take it? Did he? Oh, my God. You won't believe the extent to which this man will place himself on the line. Abramowitz in another golf bet. Between 11 and 12 on the 101.5 KGB. Celebrity news and Huey Lewis of the news in the final hour in the best of DSC, the Chainsaw on sports. We make the definitive list of the hottest guys and the hottest chicks. It may surprise you. Ilian Gonzalez has now sort of fallen into the background of the local news scene in Dade County, Miami. But just like another duck in a shooting gallery popping up to take his place, there is another young immigrant boy in trouble in America in crisis, and the news media is there. We'll have the Chainsaw on sports coming up just after the 9 o'clock hour on the best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. Right now, it is up to you to do your very best. 888-570-1015. Put yourself on the line to see if you can stump the joke czar. It's the best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. 101.5 KGB FM San Diego.
Thomas.
Yes.
First up on Stump the Joke Czar. You glad it's Friday?
Oh, yeah.
Me too, pal.
All right.
Long week. Let's hear your joke.
What do you get when you line up all the women in Oklahoma?
Full set of teeth?
No.
Here's the way it works. You dial me up, 888-570-1015. Give me your joke. Give me the whole setup. Go right up to the punchline and then stop. If I do not know the punchline of your joke, it's because it's not funny. Huh?
That's clever. I like that.
Well, that's the only way I could not know the punchline to your joke. After all, I am the joke czar. Here we go. Here is Kathy. What's up, Kathy?
Hey, how you guys doing today?
Good, good. What are you doing today?
Working.
What kind of work?
I'm a publishing editor.
Two.
Whoa.
Man, that sounds like hard work.
Sounds like a smarty pants job.
Sounds like a real job.
Yeah.
It's fun. I like it.
Good. Let's hear your joke.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, a man goes into a bar. Sits down and orders a drink. As he's sipping his drink, he hears a voice say, "Nice tie you're wearing." He looks around, but there's nobody in the bar except him and the bartender. He passes it off, and then he hears, "You're a really sharp dresser." Now he's puzzled and knows he hasn't had that much to drink, and there's still nobody in the bar. He sips his drink again and hears, "You seem like an intelligent guy." By now, the bartender notices that the guy's looking really perplexed and says to him, "Are you hearing voices?" He says, "Yes," and the bartender says,
"It's the peanuts. They're complimentary."
Right.
Get it?
Got it.
I get it. Hey, Kevin, how you doing?
Doing pretty good, Dave. How you doing?
Tip top, pal. Let's hear it.
All right. What's the difference between a BMW and a porcupine?
Well, on a porcupine, the pricks are on the outside. Let's hear it, Jason.
Hey, you douche.
Hey.
Why don't blondes use vibrators?
Chips their teeth.
One of my favorites.
Kevin. going on, dude?
I'd like to tell a joke to you.
You'd like to what?
Tell a joke to you.
Oh, okay. What are you doing today, Kevin?
Going to school right now.
What grade are you in?
Fourth.
Okay.
Do you catch a polar bear?
How do you catch a polar bear?
Yeah.
Is this the one where you have to dig a hole in the ice and open up a can of peas and sprinkle all the peas around the hole and you wait for the bear to come up and eat the peas, and when he does, you sneak up and you kick him in the ice hole?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thanks. See you later.
It was cute.
Kick the ass of a little 9-year-old right there.
Oh, I hope you feel good.
I feel just fine. Not everyone can do it.
Well, yeah, you're right.
Known that one?
I remembered it when you told it, but I did not.
Uh-huh.
I wouldn't have known it just to come up with it.
Yeah, when they come up for that cure for all the diseases. Oh, yeah, I knew that. I knew it as soon as you told me.
I'm not saying I didn't know it. I mean, I couldn't have come up with it.
Oh, I remembered that cure, sure.
But I remembered it once you told it.
Well, let's see if you know this one.
Okay.
You ready to go?
I'll try.
Here's, this is custom tailored just for you, Shelly.
Oh, really? Okay.
Anthony.
How you doing? Love your show.
I love yours. This is just for Shelly. Oh,
okay. What do you give a 70-year-old woman for her birthday?
We're all trying to figure that out. What do you give a 70-year-old woman for her birthday?
70-year-old man?
Yeah, that's it.
Because no.
That's so darn funny. Count?
Depends.
No.
Well, that's a good one.
What do you give a 70-year-old woman for her birthday, Anthony?
Mikey, he'll eat anything.
Ugh.
Ew.
Oh. I'm going to give him the tickets, but
yeah.
It does not count against our record because the count came up with an acceptable punchline.
Yes, he did.
It depends.
Yeah.
That was funnier.
Yeah.
Get it?
All right, here is Pete next year on Stump the Joke Star. Let's hear it, Pete.
Hey, Dave. How you doing?
Tip top. How are you?
All right. Okay. So Johnny comes home and he asks Dad, "Hey, Dad, what's the difference between hypothetically and reality?" He goes, "Well, Johnny, go upstairs and ask your mother if she boinked the mailman for $500,000.
Boink the mailman?
Boink the mailman.
Okay. For $500,000?
For $500,000.
Okay.
So he goes upstairs and asks Mom if she'd boink the mailman for $500,000. She says, "Hell yeah, I'd boink the mailman for $500,000 and every other man that it came across." So he goes downstairs and tells Dad, "Yeah, Mom says, yeah, she would, but I still don't understand. What's the difference?" So he goes, "Well, Johnny, go upstairs and ask your sister if she'd boink the boy next door for $500,000. So he goes upstairs and does the same thing, comes back down, and she says, "Hell yeah, I boinked the mailman,
boy next door."
Yeah.
The boy next door, yeah.
For $500,000.
For $500,000, and every boy on the block. So he goes downstairs and tells Dad that,
what his sister said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, but I still don't understand. What's the difference between hypothetically and reality?
Dad says, "Hypothetically, we're millionaires. Reality is, we live with a couple of sluts." See you later now. Bye-bye.
One of my favorites.
Shut up.
Ruth, I love it when you laugh, girl.
Shut up.
That was funny.
Shut up.
Shut up.
Count, you want one?
Sure, let's give it a try, David.
Here we go. Jason.
Yes, sir.
Let's hear it.
The midget from Fantasy Island opens up a hotel.
Tattoo?
Especially for other midgets.
Little midget hotel, huh?
Yeah, a little midget hotel. And if they don't have any money, he doesn't charge them. What's the name of the hotel?
You know what? It's actually the rooms, coincidentally or interestingly enough, are about 50% smaller than those of a regular, like a Holiday Inn.
Right.
He calls them Stay Free Mini Pads.
Yeah.
Now get the hell out.
Get it.
Yeah. Want to try another one there, Count?
Sure.
All the cool. What's the matter? You feeling weak today?
Yeah.
All the cool guys are named Dave. Let's hear it, Dave.
Dave, good morning. All right, there's two sisters, a brunette and a blonde. They inherit the family farm and $1,000. Well, they're raising cattle, but they need a bull. So the brunette says, "I'm going to go one town over and go look at this bull this guy has for sale. If I like it, I'll send you a telegram and you come pick it up." And he says, "Okay." So the brunette goes and looks at the bull and decides everything looks good. The farmer says, I can't take anything less than $999. So she pays the man, has $1 left, goes to the telegram service, and the guy at the service says, well, it's a dollar a word. What do you want to send? And she thinks about it. She says, send my sister the word comfortable.
Comfortable?
Says, comfortable.
All right.
And the guy says, how the hell is she going to know to get your bull with just one word? And the brunette says,
comfortable.
Damn it.
I hate to break on that one.
Yeah,
that one was a big suck sandwich.
Come on, people. A-list material only,
yeah,
okay?
That's boy's life.
That was a homemader.
Yeah.
That's on a popsicle stick somewhere. Okay. 888-570-1015 is the number. I know you can do better than that. We'll get you on the air next here on KGB.
Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. 101 KGB. Prepare for full sensory attack. Learn to listen with the inner ear.
Yeah! How does it feel?
It feels good.
Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw.
The DSC.
There is no need to adjust your set.
You're shagadelic, you're switched on, you're smashing.
Stay tuned to this channel.
This is the KGB.
After 7 o'clock, just roll away from me. Good morning, that's your Triple Time WKGB San Diego. All right, stump the jokes are. How many winners so far, Chris Boyer?
Kevin, we have no winners.
I'm sorry, it's Czar.
Czar.
Thank you, Count.
Czar David, we have no winners.
I am the joke Czar. Boyer is the Count of the Court of Kooks. And, of course, the Court of Kooks here. For the assist on any jokes that we might be momentarily stunned on. Let's continue. 888-570-1015, our number. You give me the joke, stop at the punchline, and I'll give it to you. Here's Jim. What's up, Jim?
Dave, how you doing?
Tip-top pal, better now that you're on the show. Let's hear it.
Okay, what do you call a blonde skeleton in a closet?
Say it again.
A blonde skeleton in a closet.
What do you call that?
Yes.
I know.
World champion of the hide-and-go-seek game.
All right, I gotta go.
I love that one.
You seemed anxious there.
I wanted to do it. That was one of the few that I knew.
Pick a number. We'll let you field one.
All righty. 16.
16 it is. Here we go. Bruce.
Good morning.
Let's hear it.
What does the movies Titanic and The Sixth Sense have in common?
Oh, new material.
What do the movies Titanic and The Sixth Sense have in common? Let's hear it, Bruce.
The Sixth Sense is, I see dead people. The Titanic is, I see dead people.
Whoa. Might win you a blue ribbon at the fair, but...
Mm-mm.
Homemade.
No.
Look, it's not... It's not clever time. Mm-mm. It's joke where you instigate people to laugh.
That's what we're going for.
We're not sitting here, oh my golly, that is clever.
Oh,
you know? I say what?
We're not drinking Chardonnay and eating caviar. Yeah. Come on.
It's jokes. How do you get a nun pregnant?
Right.
Come on.
Come on.
Oh, that's funny.
Huh?
No, that's funny.
Is that one of your favorite truths?
Yeah. I like the monkey one better, though.
How do you get a monkey pregnant?
No.
Same punchline.
Oh, no. That's right.
Shut up.
Here's Tom next year on the KGB. How you doing there, Tommy?
Good morning, Dave. How are you?
Tip top, pal. Let's hear it.
Well, this family, they save up their pennies, and they are from the Midwest, and they want to see the world-famous San Diego Zoo.
Oh, you know, we got a little teddy bear over there.
Yes, we do.
Yep.
Anyway, they get to the zoo, and they're taking Billy from cage to cage and showing him, oh, these are the gorillas. Here's the rhinoceros. And he's having a great time, and they turn around, though, and he's gone. And they're looking all over the zoo for him. They're frantic. And They look over and they see him in the elephant cage.
In the cage?
Inside the cage.
Oh, my goodness.
And he's putting peanuts up the wrong end of the elephant.
Oh, no.
What's the... Yeah. You don't mean up the where the sun don't shine.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness.
I can tell I'm dead now. Anyway, the parents run over there and say, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" And he said, "Well, I asked the other end of the elephant if he wanted any peanuts, and he didn't say anything. So I came back here and asked, and he said..."
What do you say, Tom?
A few.
Next.
No. I feel cheap and dirty.
You know, I'm not trying to be a hard guy. It's not because I didn't know it. I'm not laughing. I want to laugh.
Right.
I want to laugh.
Kind of the point of the show.
A few?
It's a fart joke, James.
Yeah, a fart sound? No, forget about it.
I want to laugh so desperately so. Here is Dave next year on the KGB. Dave, let's hear it.
Hey, what's the best way to clean a men's restroom?
The best way to clean?
Yeah.
A men's restroom.
Not a men's best. Yeah, a men's restroom.
Okay, what? What's the best way to clean a men's restroom?
Go in and say, "Nice dick."
You mean clear. No.
Clear, clean, yeah, whatever.
Oh, get out of here.
Oh.
No, the joke
Jokus interrupt us.
The joke is, what are the two words you never want to hear in a men's room?
Well, whatever. I know it's not the best way to clean a men's room.
Stupid.
Let me try this one here. Russ, how you doing?
What's up, Dave? Hey, hey, how do you turn a dishwasher into a snowplow?
Say it again.
How do you turn a dishwasher into a snowplow?
Give her a shovel.
And the bitch a shovel.
Nice.
That's not funny.
Huh?
That's not funny.
We can only laugh because we live in a place where it doesn't snow.
All right. This is going to take some caution here.
Uh-oh.
How you doing there, Greg?
Hey, Dave. Is this Dave Smelly and Chain Wax?
That must be us. What's up?
Well, I got a joke for you if you got the time.
Okay, there, Molly.
Right there.
What's the difference between a fat, hairy chick and a bowling ball?
Good God.
Oh, gee, Paul, you think you can get that, Maul? You can only get three fingers and a bowling ball.
Not the way I heard it.
Wait a minute. Let's hear the difference.
What's the way you heard it, Greg?
If you're really, really hungry... You can eat
a bowling ball. Yeah. Give it to him.
Yes. Better punchline.
Yeah, it is.
Better punchline. See, we want to laugh.
That's right.
Want to laugh. All right, let's go with Yvonne next here on the KGB. Hey, Yvonne.
Hey, how you doing?
Tip top, baby. Better now that you're on the show.
All righty. Thank you. Guy walks into a tattoo parlor and says to the merchant, "I want a tattoo on my penis." And the merchant looks at him. He goes, "Man, you gotta be nuts." He goes, "Why on earth would you want a tattoo on your penis?" The guy goes, "Look, I have three really good reasons why I want it. The first reason is I like to touch my money." He goes, "The second reason is I like to watch my money grow." And he goes, "The third and most important reason is..."
Well, you haven't told the joke completely yet. You didn't tell us what kind of tattoo he wants on his penis.
I said tattoo of $1,000 bill.
Did she say that?
No.
No, you didn't say that part.
That part.
Okay, sorry. Tattoo of $1,000 bill.
Oh, okay, all right. Well, now I know it then, because his wife can pull $1,000 like nobody's business.
Right. There you go.
Thanks, Yvonne.
I'm hanging up in shame.
Yes, you are, indeed. Bye-bye.
I wondered what that had to do with touching his money.
Huh?
I didn't know what that had to do with touching his money.
He likes to play with his money.
Right.
He likes to watch his money grow.
Grow.
Blah, blah, yada, yada, blah, blah.
That's right.
All right, let's go with Paul next here on KGB. Let's hear it, Paul. Time on the card. That is a pity. Linda, let's hear it.
Hi, this is Linda. Why did the elephant step on the marshmallow?
Now, do I really want to know this, Linda?
Uh-huh.
This isn't going to be like a family circle joke, is it?
No.
This isn't
This isn't out of Love Is by the horoscope, is it? Is this a Ziggy?
What's the punchline?
Why did the elephant step on a marshmallow, Linda?
Mm-hmm. To get his foot out of the hot chocolate.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Bye-bye.
Oh, brother.
Next.
Vern tells better jokes than that.
God. You know, this isn't Ziggy Radio. Okay?
I don't even get it. Wouldn't the marshmallow be in the hot chocolate?
I don't know. It's one of those...
Highlights, Goofus and Gallant.
No, even Gallant wouldn't tell that joke. Gallant would bitch slap Goofus for telling that joke. He'd step out of his Boy Scout role, and he'd give him a... off the back. Goofus,
what
damn it!
Thinking?
No more lame jokes. Come on! Must be rough being Gallant.
Yes. It is, David.
All right, let's take a timeout.
Still recoiling, Chris Boyer.
We're going to quit on that?
No, there's going to be more.
Back. We're just taking a little rest. We need a little...
I need to get bagged.
The best of DSC.
This used to be a cool station until they put these dorks on.
101.5 KGB.
Dave Shelley and Chainsaw.
It's well funny it hit to you.
Final round here of Stump the Jokes are. Had only one winner so far, and it was a good joke.
Yeah.
I was glad to pay out. We've got tickets for the big on back, the old Mission Beach Athletic Club party. Every once in a while, they get a girl in a bikini walking around there.
Hmm.
So if you're into that kind of thing. Ruth, you must love these things.
What things is that?
Huh?
The what things?
Wait a minute. You've never been to... An over-the-line party or an on-back party?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Chicks walk around naked all the time showing their boobs.
Not as much as I used to.
I used to go
when I was young and skinny and kind of be part of that.
Yeah, walk but don't you like to go and just, you know, gawk at the chicks?
Meat gaze?
Well, yeah.
That's a teeth gaze.
Oh. You a teeth gazer?
Oh, big time I'm a teeth gazer. Ooh, I'd like to see those. I don't deny it like Chainsaw does.
Chainsaw's a teeth gazer, too. He doesn't deny.
Well, no, I mean being a meat gazer. He denies everything we call him. But.
All right, here is Fred next on Stump the Jokes. Let's hear it, Fred.
Okay, Dave. Hey, what's the difference between a blimp and 365 waha-wahas?
All right, let me see here. A blimp? Is that what you said, a blimp?
Yes.
A blimp. Mm-hmm. Let's see, what kind of blimps are you? Got the Snoopy blimp.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You got
I've even seen a Russell Stover's blimp.
MetLife blimp.
Yeah.
There's a
Fuji.
Blimp for some,
Fuji
yeah.
Blimp, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I can't think of any other blimp.
Hmm.
That's the only blimps I can think of. Hmm. And 365, let's see, what is 365?
Well.
That's, well, it's a number. I can't think of what 365 is specific to, though. What are
not Ty Cobb's lifetime batting average. That was 367. People say 368.
How many degrees are there in a compass?
360.
No, wait, that's 360.
Yeah.
What did he batted 367?
Lifetime.
Wow, that'd be a really good year. Huh.
Good year.
Huh? Mm.
Wait a minute.
Wait, I'm working it out.
I just can't come up with it,
no.
Fred.
Oh, I know you know it.
See you later, Fred. We're done toying with you now, Fred.
And it's not what's the difference. It's
what is the difference?
What is the difference?
A blimp is a good year, and
365 waha waha is
it's
a great year.
Great year.
Oh, got it. Okay.
Get it?
Well, I thought the punchline would be they're both a really good year. If you get 365 waha waha wahas, that's a good year.
Great.
And if you have a blimp, that's a good year. That's a good year. Oh, play your little music again. Come
oh,
on.
My little music.
Yes.
My little music.
I'm stupid, so I have to demean you.
All right.
Let's try to pick up the pieces of this bit.
Come on, and I get it.
Oh, yeah.
Let's go with Bill next year on KGB. Hey, Bill.
Hey, how's it going?
Well, not too good. I just got shot down by someone who was having a really bad moment. Let's hear it.
No. All right, what does a girl from Tennessee say to her lover after sex?
Get off me, paw. You're crushing my smokes.
Suck it, Dave.
I'm boogieing right now because I'm feeling pretty good. It's a Friday and I got all the moves.
Share boogie.
Oh, right God. There, a little mohawk for you.
Thanks.
You betcha.
My day is complete.
Tell me again about the blimp.
Shut up.
Come on, I want to hear it.
Because
it was
on.
A better joke the way you were telling it.
Stop it.
God. See, one is a good
right,
year. And the
right.
other one's a good year.
We could move on and forget the ugliness. But
wait a minute now. Wait. Shouldn't it be what they have in common?
Just move on. Thank you.
Today, aren't
huh?
Today?
Me? I'm always in a good mood.
Well, you seem extra delighted today.
Yep. Yeah, I didn't have to have sex with a man. What are you kidding me?
Shut up.
Let's go with Bob next year. This intrigues me. Hey, hello? Bob, let's hear it.
Your mother and father got in a fight. Who would you stick up for?
If your mother and father get into a fight, who would you stick up for? All right, Bob, you got us all stumped. What's the answer?
Stick up for your father. He stuck it up for you.
I blame myself.
Next.
Wait a minute. Maybe you should stick it up for your mother. Because your mother got stuck up for you.
Stop it. Just stop it.
How about that?
You know, don't take... This is misguided disappointment. You're disappointed in his joke. You're taking it out on me.
I don't know.
Wait a minute.
I've got a 10:45. Move it along.
Dad stuck it up for Mom. Hold on.
All right, back boy. What do you got to say? What do you got to say, Mr. I can't move below the waist? Okay.
Wow.
All right. I thought so. Thank you. What's
all right.
On?
Hello.
The mind still works.
Hi.
Hi.
Is this Dana?
Yes, it is.
Hey, Dana. How you doing?
Actually, it's Dana.
Dana, I beg your pardon.
Thank
I'm sorry.
You.
No one gets that right, though.
No, they don't.
No, so why don't you just go with Dana and do us all a favor?
I know.
How do you spell it?
Same, D-A-N-A.
Well, I got news for you. That's Dana.
No.
Okay, let's hear your joke.
Okay.
Dana.
Oh, there were two guys, and they were hanging around talking to each other, and the one guy says to the other guy, have you ever heard of a Freudian slip? And the guy says, well, no, I never have. He said, well, it's like this. I was standing in line at the airport, getting ready to buy tickets to Pittsburgh. And I got up to the counter, and there was this very buxom young woman standing there.
Oh, I hope he didn't ask for two tickets to Pittsburgh.
He did, but that's not the punchline.
I know.
Oh, no. Okay, so. So the guy said, oh, I understand now.
One day I was having breakfast with my wife, and I meant to say pass the sugar, but instead I said, you selfish bitch, you ruined my life.
Oh, man.
Ah, sorry, Dana. Bye-bye. Yeah, but what would he have said?
Oh, fine.
What if he was asking for the butter, though? Wait, what if he was asking for 365 wah-wah-wahs all at once?
Would you pass me that piece of paper?
Pass me that gun.
Let's go with Matt next here on Stump the Joke Star. Let's hear it. Matt.
All right. Guy gets a call from an emergency room doctor. Emergency room doctor says, it looks like your wife was in a horrible car accident.
Oh, no.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
He says your wife was in a horrible car accident.
Horrible car accident on the way home, and we got some bad news and good news for you.
Okay.
Guy says, okay, give me the bad news. You might as well. Says, well, looks like she's lost the use of her arms and her legs, and she's probably going to have to be in a wheelchair for the rest of her life, and she's on a respirator, and she'll probably never be able to talk. And guy's like, oh, my God, that's horrible.
That is
what
terrible.
Could possibly be good after that? Punchline?
I give up.
I'm kidding. She's dead.
What'd you say?
I'm kidding. She's dead. That's what the doc says.
God.
I thought he said something completely different. I thought it was the old punchline. I thought he said he was getting TiVo, you know? I don't know.
What if?
I'm blindsided by that one.
Did I miss it?
No.
No, it's like, just it was just really bad.
It's just awful.
It was just horrible.
Awful.
Okay, wait a minute. So the good news is she's dead?
Yes.
You'd rather have that than have to deal with the other, apparently.
It's not even a joke that you can explain. It's just stupid.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just not good.
Yeah.
This one, it's not me.
The premise was icky.
It's definitely not you, Shel.
The bad news was icky. The good news was icky.
Okay.
It's definitely not you, despite the fact that you very nearly turned over your papers to be a member of the Court of Kooks just moments ago on the old Goodyear and 365
all right,
joke.
Fine.
The old blimp of the Waha Waha joke.
Yeah, I thought I knew that one. I thought that one was going to be... I think she choked on it.
No, see, what I thought it was is the bad news is...
Right.
All this other stuff is happening. Well, what could possibly be the good news? Well, you know, my really good-looking nurse, I'm nailing
it. Nailing it, right, yeah. That would have been funny.
But it wasn't funny, so...
No, it wasn't funny. To the guy, it was funny, and he laughed.
He laughed!
But I suspect there are problems within him.
Yes, I agree. Hey, what's going on, Chris?
Oh, not much. Just ready for work.
What do you do?
I work for a security company.
Are you a security guard?
No, I was, but now I work in the office.
You sound way too nice and sweet to be a security guard.
Oh, well, it's event security, not like walking around with a gun or anything.
So you just show people where their seat is?
Yeah, something like that. Make sure nobody gets out of line.
Fantastic.
But I'm not sweet.
What would you do if someone got out of line?
I would just, get on the radio and call the big guys to come in.
That's what I thought. You're way too sweet and cute to be a badass.
Oh, thanks.
You're welcome. Let's hear your joke.
Okay, there's this guy from the South, and he's going to the doctor to get a vasectomy. And they tell him, okay, you're okay, come back to me. So he comes back the next day all dressed out in a three-piece suit. And the nurse says to him, what are you doing? Why are you all dressed up? And he says,
well, if I'm going to be impotent, I'm going to look impotent.
Oh, they told you the answer.
No.
Are you kidding me?
No.
That was on the third tablet that Moses dropped on the top of Mount Sinai.
Didn't Jesus slap Shecky of Nazareth for telling that one at the Last Supper roast?
In fact, he did, David.
What happened the last time you heard that joke?
I fell off my dinosaur and broke my wooden underwear. The first time they told that joke, the Dead Sea was merely sick.
All right, now we've gotten bad.
Yeah, it's...
All right, let's go with Lucky 13 here. How you doing there, Tom?
Pretty good. How you doing, Dave?
Good.
Love your show.
I love yours. Let's hear it.
Why do the cops always go after the Johns instead of the prostitutes?
That's a good question. I've always wondered that. Why do the cops always go after the Johns instead of the prostitutes, Tom?
It's a lot harder to run with your pants down around your ankles than it is with your skirt up around your waist.
See, that's just like a police fact, and it's not
a
joke.
Yeah, it's not really true.
It's just stupid.
And it's not true. They usually do go after the prostitutes and not the Johns.
You can run with your skirt.
Hey, Bob.
Yep.
How you doing there, Bob?
Pretty good.
Bob, Jennifer, Bob.
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 Bob. Hi, Bob.
Bob.
All right, Bob, let's hear it. Did I tell you guys, I went to a comedian show one time, and the guy starts talking to people in the audience. This is over at, where was I? Place in La Jolla.
Comedy Store.
Comedy Store. Yeah. Guy starts talking to people in the audience. What's your name over there? John. Oh, yeah. Nice to meet you, John. What's your name over there? Bob. And everyone in the audience started going, Bob.
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 Hey, Bob.
Bobby.
Bob.
Let's hear your joke, Bob.
How do you circumcise a whale?
You send down four skin divers, Bob. Bye, Bob.
Quick.
Later, Bob. Bye, Bob.
Shut up, Chainsaw.
I wasn't mocking you. I was mocking Bob.
Laugh. Well, you were laughing like me. Laugh like yourself.
I was laughing.
Bob is funny. That was a good
joke. I'm getting a new laugh.
No.
Yeah. I was laughing at Bob.
No, he'll stop. He'll stop mocking you. I love your laugh. Don't change anything.
Shut up.
Don't make her change her laugh. I love her laugh. Her laugh makes me laugh. When something's not funny, but she laughs, then I laugh. It's like Popeye just heard the best joke in the world.
It's the sincerest form of flattery, oh my.
Oh, yeah.
Don't change it, Ruth.
No, don't. Seriously. Then what would I have?
All right, Pat, let's hear it.
Okay. You've got three lawyers standing at the top of a building. They're all going to jump up and commit suicide. One's a defense attorney, one's a tax attorney, one's a divorce attorney. Which one hits the ground first?
Who cares?
You got it.
I took a shot.
That was just like candy from a baby.
I took a shot.
Yeah.
I don't know. A baby will put up a better fight for a sucker. Come on, I want to finish on a good one.
Which only means you've tried.
Here's Michael.
Hey, Dave.
How you doing, pal?
I'm doing okay. How about you?
Tip top. Let's hear it.
Okay. Why do men like Waha Waha so much?
Because it's the only time they can get 5 minutes of silence.
Good answer, but not the right one yet.
All right, what's your answer?
It's the only time they get something straight in a woman's head. Well, somebody laughed.
I did.
Oh, good.
It worked for me. Good. Hang on.
Whatever.
No, I don't think that's very funny. I'm still working on that flip.
Isn't it the weekend yet?
That kind of reminds me of the old, why is it so much easier to make snow men than snow women?
Because...
Come on, Joe. Come on.
Something about you knock the...
No.
You have to hollow out the snow head.
Oh! What a horrible thing to say.
That's the punchline of the joke.
You have to hollow out their little snow heads?
For the men, yeah.
No, it's because the women are so curvy. It takes extra time to sculpt them.
Like, that's a joke. Funny.
You know what?
That's not funny.
I'm not going to continue with this kind of sexist bigotry.
You.
Please.
Continue with it. You feed on it. Come on.
You've really pooped up Stump the Jokes are here today.
Poop up anything.
With your refereeing of the telling of the jokes. Why don't we just get you a striped shirt and a whistle?
I don't want to be the ref. I was just trying to get the Goodyear joke. That's all.
My goodness. Hollow out their little ice heads. What a horrible thing.
Well, isn't that the punchline?
Not in my world, sister.
What's the punchline?
Because you have to sculpt the curves and everything.
That's not funny.
Did I say it was a joke?
Well, you did, yes.
I posed a question. It reminds me of the old question. What a horrible thing to say about women. Turn over your now card.
I don't have a now card.
You're a Democrat, aren't you?
No, I'm not a Democrat.
Oh, okay. Right.
Oh, God. But I play one on the radio.
Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. 101 KGB.
101.5 KGB. It's the best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw. Cajon Speedway action returns tonight, 6:45. The green flag. You'll have... train races tonight after the big events. Train races after the main events. So check that out. Sportsman Streets and the Ponies, as well as the GA Modifieds, take to the track tonight. The Bombers are off. Randy Wallace and the KGB 101.5 race team. Boyer the Destroyer and Gary Vincent all taking the night off in the trifecta, the troika of KGB race cars. All got those bad boys in the shop, buffing them out, making them look nice for next week. But let's get to something that happened in the sports world. I tell you, it could not happen again in a million billion years, and I almost guarantee it. With details now, let's go back to this report from yesterday's show on the best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw on the 101.5 KGB FM San Diego.
KGB, the Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw radio show. Chainsaw, who is the coach of the Knicks?
Jeff Van Gundy.
Did you hear what happened to him the other night?
No.
He had a bad night. The Wednesday game, this is the one I thought they should have won this game. I thought the Knicks should have won that game. But they ended up losing in Miami 87-81. They fall behind 3-2 in the playoff series. Then as the team's 737 jet was taxing to its gate at Westchester County Airport, 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
They got a 737 at Westchester County Airport. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. They've lost. They've fallen down to 3-2.
Yeah.
The pilot revs an engine to turn, and the jet blast sent Van Gundy's car flying on top of other cars.
You're kidding me.
Oh.
And check this out. Is the New York Knicks not a is that team not one of the marquee teams of the NBA?
Well, they made the finals last year.
But I mean, in general, just in the NBA,
absolutely.
I mean, it's New York City.
Sure,
the Knicks.
Yes,
Jeff Van Gundy drives a 1995 Honda Civic.
Well, that's a big car for him.
Is he a big guy?
He's a small man. He's got about 2 hair strands. He's still doing the comb over thing.
Oh boy.
Yeah, he looks like Larry Fine, bald.
The jet blast sent Van Gundy's 1995 Honda Civic spinning over the tops of other cars, demolishing it.
Oh, my gosh.
Also extensively damaged were guard Allen Houston's 97 Mercedes, assistant coach Malone's 99 Lincoln, and the car belonging to the team's media relations director, who is not cool enough for us to tell you what kind of car he drives.
Well, I get it now, because apparently the Knicks have parking spaces very close to the tarmac, now that I'm thinking about it, as you read that story, because I can't imagine.
Oh, no. The jet was right there.
Right.
It's Westchester County. I mean, come on. These are people of privilege.
Private thing.
You know, they walk off the plane. They walk downstairs. They don't walk into the airport.
Exactly.
None of that news.
I gotcha.
Turned around. Car turned around. And I didn't know a jet could do that, just taxiing. But the jet engine blew a car into the air and crashing into 3 other cars.
That's pretty cool, David.
I would have loved to seen that.
Me too.
Now, in the movie Tin Cup, Pushing Tin.
Yeah.
Pushing Tin with John Cusack and Billy Bob Thornton, one of their rituals, rites of passage as tough guys, is to sit down on the tarmac as the plane flows overhead. And what do you call that?
Jet wash.
Jet wash. Yeah. Blows them up from the ground and flips them, and then they land.
Really?
You're kidding.
Very dangerous. And the special effects of those two bodies flying and doing, you know, Greg Louganis triple gainers off the tarmac and then being thrown down in a heap.
I got to go see more movies, seriously. Yeah. You live a much cooler life than I do.
Well, I guess, you know.
You saw Gladiator. You've seen Pushing Tin.
Wow.
What?
Well, I believe Pushington was a rental.
Oh.
No, actually, I think I saw that on a plane. Which is not very reassuring.
Cool guy.
All right, a final check on sports for the week. Here is Chainsaw on KGB. Good morning.
Well, good morning, and thank you, David. And hello again, everybody in the sports world. Yesterday in Florida, Padres starter Stan Spencer became a victim of his own slow delivery as 10 Marlins stole bases off him, including 4 in the first inning, but the veteran right-hander allowed only 2 Florida runners to score. While his teammates backed him up with 6 runs for a 6-2 final tally, Padres take 2 out of 3 against the Marlins. Move on to Atlanta today, where Brian Meadows will duel Terry Mulholland, beginning at 4:40 our time on our sister station, Kogo AM 600. Elsewhere in baseball, Mark McGwire tattooed a trio of taters, 3 home runs, bringing his career total to 539, 8th on the all-time list, and was 17 on the season, on pace to hit 69 and finish this particular year with 591, which would place him 4th all-time, behind only Hank Aaron's 755. Babe Ruth 714, and within striking distance of Willie Mays 660. Meanwhile, in the National Bank.
So we're set to go here in the 8th. It'll be Mark Tuttle, followed by Steve Orozco, then the hard-hitting shortstop, Sabito Menezes.
As in the game.
Mark Tuttle, 1-for-4 today.
Tuttle.
Picked up 2 rookies back in the 6th. We were talking earlier about Tuttle, lost over 22 pounds in the offseason. Dugan winds and delivers fastball, taken for a strike. Tuttle, who last year complained of back pain throughout the season, really worked off the weight. The 0-1 taken low, 1-1. Says he feels better than he has in years. I bet. Pant legs on his uniform wrapped tightly around his newly defined thighs. Seat of his pants snug, fully accenting and cradling this youngster's athletic behind. The 1-1 pitch, swing and a miss, strike two. Boy, that pitch really fooled him. 1-2 the count on Tuttle. Good smelling youngster. Must have got a spice to him. A wonderful guy to hang around. Baseball
feet. Why does this guy talk funny like that?
It's get bought association.
Yeah, really.
Kind of like Ross Porter of the L.A. Dodgers, if you know who he is. Once down 0-3, Phillies trail Indiana 3-2 now with game 6 tonight at 3:30 our time on TNT, followed by New York-Miami. The Heat leading 3-2. I wonder how those Knicks are going to get to the ball game without their automobiles. Tomorrow, game 1 of the Western Conference Finals, Lakers-Blazers, 12:30 our time, Saturday, NBC. Second leg of the Triple Crown tomorrow, the Preakness Stakes. We're talking horse racing now. Kentucky Derby winner Fettuccine Pegasus is the favorite. Post time, 2:27 our time on ABC and other sports day.
Have yourself a Super Southern California Sports Weekend.
9:24:02. This is your 101.5 KGB Sports Network.
Oh,
wow. 20 Harleys in 20 days.
It could only be one thing.
MarsMusic.com presents the 20 Days of Thunder. Here's someone else who's picked themselves up a Harley.
Hello, caller.
You're on the air.
Hey, this is Patty Brazer. I just won a Harley Davidson.
Oh, winner every time.
You could be next to be riding a new Harley.
That's a sweet deal.
Yeah!
The 20 Days of Thunder from MarsMusic.com.
This is the KGB.
Oh. We've lived our lives a week or two now. Happily, I know I speak for myself, I hope for you, with we've lived a life without any news of a little immigrant boy that the world was wringing their hands over. Hasn't it been great?
Yes.
Well, that's over.
Oh, no. Why?
Well, what always happens when something like this?
Oh, they're going to make a movie.
No.
Oh.
I mean, I knew this was going to happen. It just opens the floodgates for all the other little immigrant children with an issue.
Right.
Here is the story. A six-year-old boy found 6 years old.
Same thing, yeah.
Floating in the Atlantic Ocean today after being set adrift from Israel on a giant matzah. The boy, Eliot Ginsburg, and his mother set out from Israel in an attempt to reach the Jewish homeland, Miami. They started out in a small boat which capsized when the American captain forgot that ocean waves near Israel go from right to left. Oh. Eliot's heroic mother quickly pieced together the matzo raft and put him on it, then drowned under the weight of her gold jewelry.
Oh, that's horrible.
Her last words to her son were reported to be, "Don't marry a shishka. She'll eat your heart out." Eliot was soon picked up by a passing gefilte fishing boat and taken to Miami. After a quick nosh, a nice piece of cake, whatever.
Yummy.
There, he was turned over to the custody of his closest relatives, his great-uncle, L'Chaim Ginsburg, and his 21-year-old female cousin, Meshuggah Ginsburg. He moved into their home in a retirement community on a golf course. Shortly thereafter, his father, Jacob Moses Ginsburg, who was still in Israel, was notified. He almost plotzed. But he was taken to the Plots unit of a nearby hospital where he was given a chicken soup capsule and released. He then demanded to come to the United States to bring his son back. Because it was on a Friday night, he walked to Miami. However, Eliot's Miami relatives opposed the way he was being raised in Israel. They claim that in Israel he had no freedom, no rights, no tennis lessons. Neighbors gathered around the Miami relative's house to prevent the authorities from taking him away. They held up signs that read, "Stay away." Every one of our sons are lawyers, and they're single, too, if you know of a nice girl. Meanwhile, they plied the boy with gifts to show him how wonderful it was in America. He was given a video game, which was promptly taken away because it could take an eye out. He was then given a dreidel and played Find the Afikoman with his little cousins. When the father arrived in Miami, he was greeted by federal officials who warned him not to go to the Miami house because it was dangerous. He responded, "What danger? There's no danger in Miami." The Jewish media pounced on this story with all its power. Headlines read, "Little boy plays outside without a sweater." Talk shows posed questions like, "What's more important, parenthood or politics? What if an American boy was held in Israel? Where can you get a nice sandwich in Miami? Guess how much I paid for this?" It was ugly.
Well, I can see how it was.
The boy's cousin, Meshuggah, became his primary caretaker because she had no job, no kids, no husband, and no skills. The situation took a toll on her. Neiman Marcus and Layman's called to see why she hadn't been in. Unbeknownst to her, the federal government was planning a secret rescue operation known as Operation Circumcise to remove the boy from the house and cut him off from his family.
Oh, no.
Just then it happened. To get into the area unnoticed, they arrived in a van cleverly disguised to look like a Chinese food delivery truck and stormed the house. Neighbors came running like a Vance when they heard the code word, TRAFE. Hundreds of other neighbors poured into the house in an attempt to prevent the boy from being taken, but they were slowed down by their need to kiss the mezuzah each time they entered. But a trap was set for the agents. To slow them down, Meshuggah had poured slippery chicken fat all over the floor.
Oh, good idea.
But the neighbors, armed only with menorahs, were no match for the agents and their weapons. The boy was taken to the waiting van, which would speed off to reunite him with his waiting father after making a few more deliveries of Chinese food.
Copycat immigrants, you just can't have it.
Little Elliot Ginsburg, whose mother's last words were, "Don't marry a shiska." I'm sorry, a shiksa. Yeah. I'm not Jewish enough to do this justice.
Oh, you did well.
"Don't marry a shiksa. She'll eat your heart out." Glug, glug. What's a shiksa? I thought it was shiska, but what's a shiksa?
Non-Jewish girl.
No, don't marry one of them.
Yeah, don't do that.
They're awful. Sorry, no offense, Shell, but, you know.
Well, I'm not going to marry a six-year-old anyway. So.
Oh, all right, fantastic.
I'm not offended by that.
That's one of those bits that was funny when I read it, but not on the air.
No, it was great.
It was great.
It was hysterical.
It was great.
Well, I enjoyed it. And once again.
We did, too.
That's all that counts.
Well, yeah.
The best of Dave Shelley and Chainsaw on 115 KGB.
101.5 KGB, the best of Dave Shelley and Chainsaw show. KGB is your summer concert connection as well as your Ombak coming out party headquarters. You'll find information on that at 101kgb.com, plus information on the concert series. Don Henley, Jethro Tull, Bob Dylan, Jefferson Starship and Sting, they're all coming to town. And the Ombak coming out party, it's June 10th. Features the world-class rockers Spencer Davis, Randy Meisner, Michael Monarch, and Rick St. Nicholas, as well as Denny Lane, all going to be playing for you in the world-class rockers at the Ombak Coming Out Party. Tickets from Ombak members or in beach area bars, they are $15. It's another $5 if you wait and get them at the door, so don't do that. June 10th, the Ombak Coming Out Party. The Ombak Coming Out Party. Is that what I said? All right, give that a look. 101kgb.com. Stick around. You've got it on the best of Dave Shelley and Chainsaw. We will figure out the hottest chicks next.
Shelley and Chainsaw. It's the KGB. Well, I hesitate to read the email that I got from Brian, but, you know, it is what the audience, it is what our public demands, and while I may find it to be an unpleasant and less than happy task,
mm-hmm.
we must do what the public demands, mustn't we?
Yes. I agree. Yes.
Dear Dave, you got to do a new list. I mean, I agreed with you on My Sharona and even your movie picks. Nothing beats Star Wars. But when the evil Seinfeld-hating Shelley won on the greatest TV show list, I felt a disturbance in the force. Oh. What was your show?
I'm trying to remember.
MASH.
MASH, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. That's a respectable
show. It's a fine show. Yeah. I think that people just started hating MASH because it was picked by someone who said they hate Seinfeld. I think that's why.
I think you have to separate that.
It's associated hate.
Yeah, but I think that is unfair to MASH. I think MASH should stand on its own as a really good television show.
Who said this was fair?
No one ever said this was fair. I was hoping.
Not in 10 years.
This was fair.
Killed two shows with one opinion.
So a guy list that will be fun for all, especially Ruth, maybe not so much for Shelley, we'll see. It's time to do the hottest chick of all time. Oh. Don't let me down, Dave, and try to encourage the seniors on the show.
Who?
The seniors on the show to pick some chicks who were actually in talkie movies. I mean, Mary Pickford was hot, but who wants to have to read Boner Baby in subtitles?
Right.
Well done.
Love your show, Brian. All right, then.
Okay. Well, I guess, should I not be involved in this?
No, you're involved.
Well, all
you're
right.
You're involved. You have to be in. The math works out with you in it.
Oh, okay.
Marilyn Monroe!
Well, I'll tell you what.
Janet Reno! Marilyn Monroe!
Well, this is going to be a short bit. Awfully short bit, David.
The hottest five chicks of all time.
All right, let me think about this.
Now, I'm thinking that you can take anybody frozen from any time, much like our
yada.
Desert Island list, just so the folks know that when someone picks Lauren Bacall, we're talking about the hot 19-year-old, you know how to whistle, don't you, just blow Lauren Bacall, not the fancy feast cat food breath. Lauren Bacall.
Well, now you're just not playing fair.
What are you going to feed your cat for dinner tonight? Fancy feast.
But in her day,
Bogey is spinning like a battling top in his grave to know that Baby is hawking cat food on
TV.
He
should have left her more money then. Well, she's trying to make a living.
Guess that's it. All righty. So, can you come up with five?
I'm trying to think.
I mean, I see you busy doing your taxes here during the show. Is everything okay? That was supposed to be done a while ago.
No, that's just withholding. I'm changing some things around.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It was a bad 2000 or 1999?
We're having to tweak a little bit with how much they take out of my check.
Are you withholding 50 relatives now?
No. We're lessening the number.
Lessening the number.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. That can be brutalizing, can't
sure,
it?
Sure, absolutely. It's going to hit me hard.
So, Ruth, do you think you can do this?
I'll give it a try.
All right. Fantastic.
Let's see.
Did we just do traffic?
No.
We didn't do traffic. Let's do our traffic. And then we're going to come back with the five hottest all-time chicks. You know how it works? We all come up with five. And then we look at the entire list. Because we need your, ultimately, audience, you are the ones who are going to decide.
Yeah.
And, you know, we should start putting our results up on the web because we've got the ultimate all-time song is My Sharona.
Mm-hmm.
The ultimate all-time movie is Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
The ultimate all-time TV show is MASH. And now we're going to have the ultimate all-time chick. Hot chick.
Okay.
It's going to be so hard.
And there's no rules to this. I mean, it could be, famous because of television, movies, politics.
Yeah.
Well, Fawn Hall. I mean, come on.
Well, yeah, that's true. You're right.
Stuffing secret documents in her brassiere. That's hot.
Fun hole.
Donna Rice, Fawn Hall.
Yes.
Come on. Mud wrestling. Let's go.
Come on.
So any arena, it matters not.
Okay.
And from any time frozen period. And then what we'll do Once we've all come up with our five, we all get to eliminate four.
Okay, right.
We'll go through the entire list, and each of us will eliminate one at a time four of these hot chicks.
It's the fun part.
And then we'll have a final five, and then you, the audience, will have to determine of those five who is indeed the hottest of hot of all-time chicks so that we can put our official Dave Shelley and Chainsaw seal of approval on it. It's not always easy to do, either.
And some feelings get hurt, frankly, but we just have to do it for the greater good.
Well, people start doing, revenge, vengeance eliminations.
Yeah, it's not right.
And, you know, I always blame Ruth for that because she's the one who always starts it.
But then you have to retaliate.
You have to retaliate.
Right. Started it.
You know what? You started it is a perfectly legal defense. It is. It is a perfectly legal
defense. Never works for me.
It's very mature.
Try it in a court of law sometime.
Well, all right.
You started it.
Works for Tommy Lasorda.
It's true. Sometimes it counts.
Yeah.
You know, you're in the middle of a fight, and what are you going to get down to? He started it.
Mm-hmm. He started it.
There you go. All right.
So stupid.
And by the way, if we overlap on any of the hot chicks, they have to be. I mean, you have to have a replacement.
Okay, have an.
If two people choose Marilyn Monroe,
okay,
only the first one who chooses it gets to use it. The other person who had it on their list has to choose an alternate.
Are we doing it round by round?
Yeah, we'll go round by round.
Yeah, okay. So you have a list of like 5 to 8, maybe eight choices.
You might want to have some spares.
Yes.
Okay. Some spares, okay? All right, it's KGB, the Dave Shelley and Chainsaw Radio Show. A new list this morning for us to go alongside the greatest movie, the best television show, the best song of all times, the hottest chick. And this really has no rules. The only rule we really have to say about this is we all have to know who the person is. I mean, if you come up with some obscure model that we don't know who it is, we really aren't going to be able to say, oh, yeah, I agree or disagree with that, right?
Yeah,
so we all have to know who it is, and that's really about it. All right. Yep. Do I get to go first for a change?
Sure.
What's the order going to be? And we just go in a circle like this? Me, Shell, Boyer, Chain, Ruth, like that?
Yes.
Sound good?
Yes.
All right.
Okay.
All right. All right. My first pick.
Someone keeping track?
Sure.
Okay. I'm going to do that because...
To have an overview of...
I need to be able to keep track of what's happening here. All right, my first pick, a brilliant strategic move, I think. And I'm going to see a lot of pens going, oh, yeah, I should have done that. My wife.
You can't choose your
wife. Excuse me, I'll play the tape back. We said...
Oh, now I got to put Susie on there, darn it.
That's always been our standing rule.
I'm sorry. I went to great pains to stipulate.
Well, I know, but we just assumed that the other...
Oh, you did what?
Assumed that
no
that we were going to play the way we always play.
You said famous people.
I said it needs to be someone that we all know.
That's right.
I was painfully clear on this.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And I just want to see which one of you is going to have the moxie to kick my wife off the list.
Not me.
So it's a new list and a test at the same time.
Oh, we'll see.
Okay.
Okay, Shell, you're up.
Well, I'm going to choose Liz Taylor from the 1950s.
Good one.
Okay. Boyer?
I'm having a mental block. Billy Joel's wife.
Ex-wife. Christy Brinkley.
Christy Brinkley.
Thank you.
Thanks for raiding my list.
That's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
David Brinkley's daughter. Shane.
Yeah. Have to go Marilyn, 1953.
Okay. And Ruth rounding out round one.
Anna Nicole Smith from Playboy.
Oh, God.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
Come on, that's the best she ever looked.
Yes, it's the best she ever looked.
Right. Okay.
It's a qualifier.
Next on my list is Farrah.
Era, please.
Yeah.
Before or after the...
That's kind of important, isn't it?
Yeah.
Just a little bit.
Before she went Lulu.
Marilyn Monroe now would not be a good pick.
No. It's never good. Farrah, the poster.
77?
Yeah, the poster.
Okay. Yeah.
Poster Farrah.
Oh, and which Beth did you want, Dave?
Yeah.
Oh, she's timeless.
Oh, good answer.
And what about timeless. Christie Brinkley?
The cover girl makeup commercial era. What would it be? Like late 70s, early 80s?
Okay.
So even though she still looks hot, too.
My turn?
Yep.
Barbara Eden from the 60s.
Jeannie.
And Mayberry RFD manicurist days.
Yeah, that's like 63, 62.
30 years ago.
Sure.
Kay Boyer, number two.
I got to take Natalie Wood.
Oh, off my list. Too bad. Era.
Before she died.
Well, there's a difference.
She's been a movie star since she was six.
You're right. She looked pretty good in The Great Race.
Great Race, perfect. Okay.
What was fantastic. That, 16?
Early 60s.
Yeah.
Okay, Chainsaw, round two.
Heather Locklear, I think I'll pull her from about 1990, even though she still looks fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's a good one. And Ruthie?
I'm going with Elle McPherson.
Okay.
Era?
Oh, early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, like 10 years ago.
Okay, round three, I'm going with Pam Anderson. And I will choose the era of 1994-1995. Right out of Tool time. Right in the Baywatch, beginning of the Baywatch time. Shell?
Raquel Welch from the 70s.
Nice.
Nice pick.
A San Diego resident. Or grew up here.
Mm-hmm.
How about, I'm going to go with, gotta pick Donna D'Errico.
Good choice.
Sweet.
Wait a minute, I'm a little unclear on her. She's blue-eyed.
The one with the eyebrows, blonde on Baywatch.
She was a Baywatch chick.
Yeah.
And in Playboy.
But popped out of the cake and under...
No, not blonde.
She was also Beverly Hillbillies.
Oh, yeah.
Did she play Ellie Mae?
Yes, she did.
Are you sure you're thinking of the right one?
No.
I don't think so. I don't know her. One. Uh-oh.
I can't place her.
I can't either, then.
Oh, God.
Was she the one who popped out of the cake and Under Siege?
I thought that was the one who was in...
Ellie Mae.
That was Ellie Mae. That's not Donna D'Errico.
Okay, I don't know her.
Donna D'Errico is married to Nikki Sixx of Motley Crue. Yeah.
And she's dark-haired and blue-eyed.
No, she is not.
Oh, I'm confusing her with someone else.
New pick, Boyer.
Sorry, Boyer.
Oh,
damn it.
Go to your fourth.
Sarah Michelle Gellar.
Damn it, you're on my list. Damn.
Buffy.
Okay. Jane?
I got to go Alyssa Milano condom commercial.
Okay, that's a good one.
Hard to beat.
Ruth?
I'm going with current Heidi Klum, swimsuit model. Heidi Klum, the model, the supermodel that's always in Sports Illustrated.
Is she blonde?
She's sort of honey blonde.
I can't picture her.
Tall, really long.
Is she married to John Stamos?
No. That's going to be my next pick.
Although she would be fine.
No, I get to pick her. I get to pick her.
Okay, keep your shirt on.
I don't have Heidi Klum.
Okay, how about Christy Turlington?
Oh, excellent choice.
All right. She's said to have the world's most beautiful, perfect face.
Yeah. She's in the Smithsonian for that. Okay, then I'm going to take Mrs. Stamos, Rebecca Romaine. What a list.
Yes.
Okay, Shell, round four.
Lauren Bacall from the 40s.
Oh, God.
What's the matter, Chan?
Nothing. I mean, that's fine.
Like 19-year-old Lauren Bacall?
Mm-hmm, yeah. Okay. Yeah, when Bogey first laid eyes on her.
To have and have not.
Boyer?
Rear Window, Grace Kelly.
Good call.
Good call.
I have that Grace Kelly Rear Window on my list as a backup.
Okay. Round four, Chainsaw.
I'll go Faith Hill.
Oh, good call.
Beautiful lady.
Pretty lady.
Pretty lady.
Yes.
Of the country and western scene.
Ruth.
Okay, okay, sticking with the mainstream, I'm going Claudia Schiffer.
Okay.
From, let's see, this is 2000, from, oh, 5 years ago.
Okay. Fifth and final round. You ready?
Yeah.
Rita Hayworth from where she's posing on that bed.
Damn it.
Damn it.
The Bale of Hay?
Huh?
The Bale of Hay?
No, no, that's Jane.
Oh, that's Jane Russell.
No,
Jane
she's on her knees. She's in like a little kind
Gilda.
Of a.
Yeah, yeah, it has to be Gilda. That's the one where she does that dance and she holds her arms straight up and they work so hard to make that dress have her breasts does not pop out.
If you ever saw The Shawshank Redemption.
Yes.
All the prisoners are watching the movies,
mm-hmm.
and they come in, and they're talking about something, and one of them goes, wait a minute, she's about to do it. And they cut to the movie, and she flips her hair up, and all the guys go, oh, God!
But long, dark, she was a brunette.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
Stunning woman.
Shelley, fifth and final pick.
Hang on.
Princess Di.
No.
Just kidding.
Well, I am torn between two.
Who are they?
No, you can't do that.
Yeah, I know.
You give fodder to other people.
Stamos, right. You picked off on the fodder.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, but I didn't.
He's the boss.
But someone yapped.
I'm going to say...
Yeah.
Quickly, before time runs out on you.
Meg Ryan.
Good luck.
Which one?
Well, can I change it?
Nope.
Which Meg Ryan?
You get an option. Remember, we're going
to
have
we're
going to have a mulligan option for
all
everybody.
Right.
That would be yours. Boyer, I mean, she's a fine woman.
Your fifth and final choice, Boyer.
We love her.
Tuesday Weld.
Oh, no.
Once Upon a Time in America, De Niro.
Oh.
Did you see her in...
I don't even really know for sure if I know who that looks like, but I'm not going to make a stink out of it.
She's the girl in Dobie Gillis?
Yeah.
Eh.
Is that the one that turned out to be a lesbian congresswoman?
No.
Well, she's still in the movies, but she's considerably older and...
Jane, your fourth pick.
Pre-Axl Rose, Stephanie Seymour.
Yeah, good choice. Uh-oh. See, right there. She's going to bounce her right
away.
All
right. Now I know what my mulligan is.
And Ruth.
Oh, Vendela.
Oh.
What do you mean? Oh, God. Oh,
how's your Sports Illustrated over there today, Ruth? Here are the choices. You ready?
Yeah.
I took Beth, Farrah Fawcett, Pam Anderson, Rebecca Romijn, Rita Hayworth. Shelley has Liz Taylor, Barbara Eden, Raquel Welch, Lauren Bacall, Meg Ryan. Boyer has Christy Brinkley, Natalie Wood. Sarah Michelle Gellar, Grace Kelly, Tuesday Weld. Chain has Marilyn, Heather Locklear, Alyssa Milano, Faith Hill, Stephanie Seymour, and Ruth has your basic swimsuit issue.
Right.
Anna Nicole Smith, Elle McPherson, Christy Turlington, Claudia Schiffer, and Vendela.
Can I change one?
Yes, you can. We all get to change one.
But not right now.
Why not?
Oh, can we right now?
Sure, why not?
Because I want to put Liz Hurley on.
Did we say it was your turn?
Oh, you better not steal
I think
her.
You're fifth. I think you're fifth on the list.
No.
She's on my island, Liz Hurley, and I'm surprised I didn't put her on my list, and I think I might.
Oh, you proud.
We all get to choose. You guys yap too much. You got to strategically.
It's just like on Millionaire where they go, I'm torn between two, and then
they say
the two, and then that's all they get left.
Did you see the poor mentally challenged
gal last night?
Gals.
Every single chick that
But I'm
got
talking
up there.
About the first one
oh, yeah.
on there.
Yeah, okay. What's magnetic north on a compass? East, west, north, south.
Well, I know it's either north or south.
A bag of hammers would have scored quicker.
She had to call a friend.
I know.
She actually got pretty high in the game. She got up to $125,000 and then had to bail.
$1,000 was nuts.
Which haircut did Mr. T make famous? Page Boy? Beehive?
Uh-huh.
Mohawk.
I have to call the audience.
I swear to God.
Or buzz
dumb
cut.
As dirt. She was dumb as dirt. She even said, I can't believe I got on the show.
Neither can I.
Right.
But at least she didn't have an annoying, nervous laugh.
Oh, God.
Oh, God.
Yeah, it was bad. I had to leave the room.
I speak for an entire nation when I say...
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, we got that taken care of.
Yes, we did.
All right, any changes we're going to make to the list? I am staying with my list because it's perfect. Shelley, any options? Elizabeth Hurley.
Going to take Meg Ryan off.
And then put on Elizabeth Hurley.
Shh.
How to put on Elizabeth Hurley.
Well, I think I'm going to let Chainsaw do that.
No, I'm not going to do it.
You're not going to do it?
Elizabeth Hurley, then.
Shut up, Dave. Do you want Liz Hurley?
No, go ahead.
Got somebody else?
Yeah, take it.
All right, Liz Hurley.
Elizabeth Hurley. Huh? What do you know?
Thanks a lot, Shell.
You yapped.
Well, who buys more Estee Lauder here?
I wish you could just shut your big yapper.
Boy, any changes?
Current. I got another one.
I want to know who you're, when we're done, I want to know who the one you were struggling with, okay?
Okay.
When we're done. Boyer.
David, I think I'm going to keep it as is.
Okay, Chainsaw.
I'm really happy with mine.
I like your list.
Mm-hmm. I have Tyra Banks as a possibility. Go ahead. Take her.
Ruth?
Yeah, I was thinking of taking her. I think I'm going to put Shania Twain on.
In place of who?
I like all these babes. In place of...
big surprise. Yeah.
How about in place of Vendela?
Okay.
Even though I love her.
All right, so the list is complete. And now we start the elimination. Process. Who was it, Shell? Who were you?
You know, and I knew this would not be popular, but I love her, and if I could look like any star,
Joni Mitchell.
No, Audrey Hepburn from the 60s.
Who?
Audrey Hepburn from like Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Ooh.
But I know it's not a popular
choice.
So really?
No, I wouldn't have pulled her off the list. No way, ma'am. No.
I was
no
going
way.
For Meg Ryan because I thought sweet, lovable, everyone loves her.
All right.
We do.
Elimination time. Shall we begin?
Yeah.
I'll start the eliminations.
Okay.
We'll take off. And I want you to know, everybody, that I am beginning this elimination process purely with getting to the hottest chick. I have no vengeance, no revenge, no malice.
That's all we want.
I am John McCain here. No rancor. No rancor.
Uh-huh.
Okay? I'm serious. Until you start knocking mine off the list and then rancor, revenge, malice.
One more quick of all of them?
No, I've done them all.
Okay.
I've done them all. And first knocked off the list is going to be Tuesday Weld. Sorry, Boyer. Just can't really place her.
No problem.
All right.
Sort of the sacrificial anode.
Okay, Shell.
I got to get rid of Pam Anderson, and I'm very sorry. I'm very sorry.
Ouch, no,
the rest of your list is going to be fine.
Ouch.
I'm sorry, but I just... She's fine and all, but it's just paid for, you know?
I have to win this, Shelley.
I know how you are, and I think you're going to do fine.
I don't know anymore.
I'm sure that's the only hit you're going to take.
I don't know. Boyer?
I'm sure it is.
You know what? She was fine if you're an 86-year-old millionaire, but I think there are probably a few hotter chicks than Anna Nicole Smith. Sorry, Ruth.
Too bad. I like that choice, though, Ruth.
Thank you.
Jane?
McCall.
Laura McCall is
Are
off the list.
Are you nuts, you crazy man? All right, fine.
Okay. And Ruth.
I'm going to go with Buffy.
Oh,
I agree with you, Ruth, because you know she's cute, but she's not beautiful.
What are we letting chicks play this game for?
She's too young.
Have you seen the makeup commercial? I don't even know what it is, but...
Oh, yes, the makeup commercial.
She's darling.
Oh, the makeup commercial.
She's not the most beautiful woman in the world.
No, she's not, and you're absolutely...
But she's not the beautifulest. It's the hottest.
She's darling.
I want to dab her face with a little pink tube.
Well, I didn't say I'd kick her out of bed for eating crackers, but you know, I gotta pick somebody.
Yeah.
I gotta pick somebody.
This is what we get for running with the seniors, Boyer.
She's too young. Gosh darn, is she in her 40s yet?
Do I have to have a reason?
No,
you
really don't.
I have to pick somebody?
Oh.
I'm sorry it hurt you.
Oh.
It wasn't even on your list, Dave.
It was. It was on my list, and then Boyer stole her. So was Natalie Wood. All right, round two of the elimination. Sorry, Shania Twain to me has never been that hot. Gotta take her off.
I know, she's very really popular.
Yeah, big deal. Tony and Chris are hurt this morning. I'm not.
We didn't know what it was until it came time to settle up on Friday morning. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. I think 98% of the people will scream and recoil in horror when they hear the wager that's on the line. today's Dave's Free Thursday Golf Bet here on the 101.5 KGB Best of Dave, Shelley, and Chainsaw.
All right, let's just get this over with, shall we?
What?
The
like
horror.
A Band-Aid, rip it off quickly.
You're not going to want to be part of this, okay?
Hello.
Yeah, I don't blame you for that. Yeah, hello, heck yeah.
What?
First of all, thanks to Herb Moore and all the great guys. We met Mike and Scott as the head pro out at Del Mar Meadows yesterday. Terrific people. What a golf course.
Mm-hmm.
What a golf course.
Yeah. Really?
Oh, my gosh. I mean, you want to talk about a special place. This is a special place. Del Mar Meadows yesterday had us out for Dave's Free Thursday Golf. We had a fantastic time. And Abramowitz and I were trying to think of a good, you know, a decent bet.
Mm-hmm.
And what's left? What have I always said I'll get Abramowitz to accept?
Breast implant?
Nope.
No.
Carrying a child?
What have I always said I'll get, sooner or later, I'll get them?
Wrap his
pants. No. Well,
it's going to be sex with a man, isn't it?
You know what? He's made out with a guy.
Yeah.
He's taken a bath with a guy.
Yeah.
He's married a guy.
Yeah.
All basically considered foreplay.
Mm-hmm.
Let's finish it off.
Well, not to mention the body shots he took off of
the belly button of Pepe. The foreplay he's had with Pepe. Mm-hmm. Isn't it time to consummate this marriage?
And he was in my face for the first... Because somebody asked Pepe, and that started the whole ball rolling. He was in my face.
You were in my face, pal.
Yeah, well.
You were in my face, and then I said, okay, bet is sex with a man.
Oh, darn it, no.
And then I said, well, what kind of sex?
Kind of sex?
When one man loves another man very much.
I mean, is it more kissing and making out like we did on Hard Rock?
Now you've done that already.
Yeah, that's not sex.
Or is it heavy petting? I don't know.
Wait, let's all think of heavy petting.
And that just ruined my game right there. To hear Abram would say to you those words right there.
Well, you talk about heavy petting, darn it.
And so...
And I had to draw a stick figure on the golf.
Oh, no.
On the scorecard to show him exactly what sex with a man is like.
And well, wait a minute. They're both facing the same way. How do you do that?
Oh, God.
Ow.
And I had a cigar in my mouth, and I had just part a hole. And I said, you know what? You're on. And I thought he was kidding. Oh, I thought he was kidding.
When is he ever
Why
kidding,
would you,
you
think
dupe?
That?
I thought he was kidding. I thought he'd say, no, forget it. No. And next thing I know, I go, okay, that's the bet.
I just laughed.
And I go, wait a minute, and he drove off. I go, wait a second. I got up to him, I go, wait. He goes, that's the bet. You're not going to Welsh again like you did out that one time when your dad said you couldn't go.
Well, this is the thing. I said, let's not even make a bet.
Yeah.
I said, I don't care what the bet is. I don't care if the bet is jump off a building without a parachute. I don't want to make another single bet if we're going to have to sit here and say, oh, I can't do it the next day because I hate it when we start something and it doesn't fit.
Yeah, I do too.
So I said, we're not going to Welsh anymore, right? No more Welching.
Well, let's finish what you started. Come
That's
on.
Exactly. If you could quote a little Sam Hagar for me.
Thank you.
So that was the wager yesterday.
You know that feeling of the cigar you were smoking yesterday, Abramowitz?
Shut up.
Get used to it.
So now all we need to do is find, and Abramowitz said to me, who's it going to be? And I said, I will guarantee you.
Uh-huh.
We have enough of a
cross-section
curious audience.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm.
That if I said... Would there be a volunteer out there, a gentleman volunteer,
right,
who would help us pay off this bet?
Well, he's already had a date with a lovely gentleman.
There was a guy who wanted a piece of him so bad.
Absolutely. Took him to Kickers.
There's Gay Joe in the audience.
Well, Gay Joe's attached.
Gregory.
I got a feeling that Gay Joe would kick down for a bit.
I've met Gay Joe. I don't think Gay Joe would.
He and his partner are real... Monogamous. Yeah, they're very.
And you were just kidding when you said it.
I don't know if you noticed, but monogamous is great. I'm married.
Well, what does that mean?
If you'd have lost the bet, you would have had.
Oh, I see.
Hello.
I see.
Here is Gay Dan.
Oh, Gay Dan, cool.
Right away, we got a...
Oh, come on.
How you doing, Dan?
Am I a winner?
Are you gay?
Am I, yeah.
Are you extraordinarily gay?
Extraordinarily?
Yes.
Oh, I could be,
yeah. All right.
Oh. I mean,
Dan, have you ever had sex with a man?
Yeah, several times.
Okay, so you know how it works.
Do I?
Do I ever?
Now, we said that... While it could be a little weird to do this on the air,
sure.
There would at least have to be a telephone off the hook in the room while it was happening. We said this.
What? No cameras?
I don't want to see it. Oh, that was another thing. He already knows what this is like a little bit because of his prostate examination.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
I want to see that ass that won't quit.
Damn.
Are you just loving this, Ruth, or what?
Yeah. But I'm thinking about poor Gregory, who must be just fuming somewhere now. moving in on his man.
Boom.
So we got Gay Dan and we got Abramowitz here.
Oh, those guys are fast.
Well, no, wait a minute.
Knock it off. Knock it off.
Dan, do they call you Beer Can Boy?
Beer Can Boy.
And the bet was, and I hope you'll go along with this, Gay Dan.
All right.
The bet was the loser at least gets the choice of what part of the battery he wants to be.
Oh, okay.
Pitcher or catcher.
Oh, okay.
What did you choose, Bromo?
Uh-oh.
This is the best part.
Yeah. I don't know. What do you mean? I don't know. I don't understand. What's a pitcher?
I know what's a pitch and a catch.
You didn't yesterday when we were talking about it.
Well, I wanted you to be specific. I wanted to have it.
Specific?
Because when I make a bet with you guys, it always has to be written in stone and, you know, and I wanted it to be specific what you were talking about. So.
Do you have a preference, Gay Dan? Because the Bromwich would prefer to catch.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking.
I actually...
First the pitcher.
I did a visual thing out there describing what it was. And
you didn't use your cigar, did you?
No,
oh, no. Oh, you're going to love it, honey.
No, I'm not going to love it. What are you talking about?
You're going to love it.
Honey. Bromwood for the old prostitute, honey.
It's going to be a whole new world for you, honey.
Third door on the left, honey.
Just be a little gentle there with him, Gay.
Tell him to bring his cigars.
Don't forget the lube.
Oh, jeez.
Lots of lube. Right.
Ruth,
that's
settle down.
Secret.
Now, Bromo?
Uh-oh.
Oh, have I lost them both? Hang on a second.
I don't know.
Here.
I think you
there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right.
Dan, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay, all right. Hang on. Yeah. Bromo, has your dad moved yet?
All of his stuff is down in Tijuana, but he's staying at my house right now.
He's at your house?
What?
Right.
At the old lady's house?
No, he's just staying there for one night.
I want to go to the haunted house.
I've forgotten what your new telephone number is.
I have it. But I don't want you to call him.
Why?
That's okay. We just need it for our records.
<All right. laughs> I don't want him to know about this. I mean, if this is something that I got to pay off. He wouldn't let me do the last one.
I think you're gay. Well, Dave. I mean, he's going down to a different country. He really doesn't have any say anymore, does he?
My dad would have a coronary heart attack.
I'm going down where the brown gals are.
Drop the soap? What?
He would drop freaking dead.
Oh, no.
Yeah, he would.
That'd be the second person in that bed.
Yeah, really. He could hang out with the old lady.
Into it, Dave.
He already knows you're gay.
The ghost of Wayne.
Dan, let me put you... Dan, don't go away. You are required for this bit. Hang on. Don't go away. Bromo.
Yeah?
Your father needs to know this before he leaves the country.
No way.
Yes, he does.
No.
Yes.
No.
He knows you're gay.
Come on, just give me your phone number.
No.
We'll just tear it off like a Band-Aid real quick.
No.
We need to tell him about the bet.
No.
Are you okay?
My name's Wayne, and I'm proud of my gay son, Dave.
He thinks you're gay anyway.
Yeah, that's right.
No.
Huh?
No. Hold on a second.
I can't believe he wanted to catch.
I think he's fainting or something.
I think so, too.
Oh, my goodness.
He wanted to catch.
Yeah, he wanted to catch.
I don't think he's capable of working up the interest to
pitch.
I had to turn my
pager off. It's been going off like five times.
Gee, who do you suppose that is?
Well,
can I call her and tell her what the bet was?
No. You can't.
Sounds
call
like
her.
She already knows.
Oh, hang on. What?
Hang on 1 second.
What? Maybe she'll call us.
Maybe she wants to help in the little make it a three way.
Oh. What are you doing? What are you doing? You don't know my phone. No, okay. You don't know my phone number.
Hello.
He's probably in your underwear drawer right now.
Getting his last little kicks of underwear before he moves down to Mexico today.
Hey, you don't know my number. No way. You don't know. The only person I gave it to was...
Darn it, hi.
Shooty.
Who would you give it to?
Shooty. Good old Shooty.
Shooty, you give...
Hey there, Dave. Sorry, I missed your phone call. Go ahead and leave a message, and I'll
listen,
get back
no
to you
singing.
As soon as I get back. Thanks a lot.
It's his new bachelor pet.
Wow.
Wayne!
Wait
a minute. How do I work this? I pick up the phone.
Just pick up the phone. Get your hand out of the underwear drawer.
Yeah. Get your little radio friends, Wayne.
Just pick up the old phone there, Wayne.
Wayne!
You know what? He probably doesn't even know where the phone is.
Hello! I don't know.
He's doing
where
a little number for the old lady ghost right now.
Come to the noise!
Wherever there's noise, Wayne, come to the end.
Hello! You guys always catch me coming out of
the shower.
Coming out of the bathroom. Hang on just a second.
Okay.
Why don't you pick up the phone?
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Why did you pick up the phone?
Well, I didn't know, Dave.
You didn't know? You have all these...
Wayne, you all excited about your big day today? You're moving down?
No, I'm not. I've got too many things to do.
I know. I got to get going right now.
Well, then you got to get going, right, Dad? You got to go right now, right?
I got to get going pretty soon.
Hey, you know what day of the week yesterday was, Wayne?
It was Thursday.
And you know what we do on Thursday?
Oh, well, I know you play golf.
That's right. Sometimes we bet on those games.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know. Hey, your son wants to tell you what the bet was yesterday.
He does?
No, I don't, Dad. I don't.
Do you prefer pitching or catching, Wayne?
What? I am not very good at either one.
I know, but if you had to choose,
remember the old baseball days, Dad? I remember being baseball.
Oh, yeah. If you had to choose, Wayne, would you be a pitcher or a catcher?
Oh, I'm probably, with my fastball, I'm probably better.
It's hard to believe that he's not good at either when he rated himself as a solid eight.
I know it.
What are you, a better pitcher or better catcher, Wayne?
Let's see. Well, I don't excel at either one, but...
But if you had to choose...
God, if I had to choose...
today.
Let me see. I have
hey, Dad.
Just let him say.
Let's see. I think I... my eyes are kind of shot right now. I think I'd rather throw.
You'd rather pitch?
Oh, yeah. Man.
Well, that works out because the problem is a catcher.
Those guys are fast.
I know. Works out great because your son's a catcher.
Yep.
Dave is the catcher?
Yeah.
Yes, he is.
Not yet.
The game hasn't started yet, Dad. You know what I mean? I know.
Yeah, some kind of baseball bet. What's that all about, son?
I take it you lost again.
Yeah, what was the final score?
Hey, Wayne, have you run into the old lady ghost there?
No. I think she died. She passed away in the hospital, David.
Nah, that's not what I heard, Dad. And you haven't been around when she's been walking around.
She's petting the cat.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, Dad. There's
taking her bathrobe back.
I heard she stole one of your flip-flops.
It's really an eerie feeling here, though, because they've left everything kind of as a memorial to
her. Well, that's
her,
what
though.
I'm saying. It's spooked up. She's walking around. She stole one of my flip-flops, Dad. The one, the red one. I used to wear my socks on with it. Anyway.
Wow.
I smell banana fish.
That's probably in one of my boxes that I've got.
Dad, I was wearing it two nights ago. It's my favorite flip-flops. I wear it when I watch TV, and I wake up this morning.
It's going to Mexico with me. No, it's the brown gals with my new shoes.
Knock it off. I came home last night, Dad. I get out of the shower.
Uh-huh.
And there's only one red flip-flop. Where did the other one go?
He's going down to Mexico with me and Consuelo.
Knock it off.
So anyway, we got a wager from yesterday's game. Who's going to tell Wayne about this? This has got like a going away present.
Yeah, it really is.
You tell him. I can't. I can't.
I'll tell him.
No, I'll bet you will, Ruth.
No, I'll tell him
let
nice.
Let me. I'll tell him nice.
How are you going to tell him nice? There's no nice way of telling this.
Yeah, there is.
That's fine if Ruth wants to do it. After all, Ruth has done this before.
There's no nice way of telling this thing.
Well,
there's...
Wayne, you know how I'm a little different than, you know, other girls
no,
are.
No, he doesn't know.
You know
well, this is Kelly or
no,
Ruth?
No, this is Kelly. That's right.
That is Ruth the carpet diver.
Ruth, I don't
know. Oh, wow.
No, I don't think I know Ruth.
Yeah.
Muncher.
You met me.
The carpet diver?
You know.
Bromo and I used to work together back when he was, you know, a board op at a different
station.
I've
never heard it called carpet diver before.
What the hell are you doing, Carmen?
What?
My mom said if you want to become a lesbian, you have to lick carpet.
She likes girls. She likes the company of girls.
Jeez.
She likes to hang out with girls.
Oh, I like the gals, too.
Me too.
Yeah.
Her girlfriend's name is...
Yeah, and actually my girlfriend and your son have a golf bet together.
Yeah, okay, well, that's another day.
Take place next month, maybe. But the reason I wanted to tell you is because his bet that he lost today is a little bit like the lifestyle that I lead, but instead of he's going to have a bet with a boy. You might have remembered Pepe from the past. Remember Pepe? He had to pay off a couple of bets with our good friend and Bromo's wife,
no,
Pepe.
No, I blocked those things out of my mind here, Ruth. Well, Ruth, nice talking to you, because I've got to go.
I got to go. I got to leave the country.
He's going to leave quicker than normal.
We have a big day here.
Dad,
Dave and I.
Dad, did you understand what she was saying?
No.
I know it.
What if Roy Acuff sang it to him? Would that make
that'd
a difference?
Be good, I think that'd be good.
Roy.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not Roy.
Hello.
Who's singing, Dave?
Hang on. We got some people who want to say hi. Here is Mike. You're on the air with Bromo and his father.
Hey, Bromo, don't do it. You can't do it.
Hello, Mike.
Welcome to my show. What do you know? I'm on the air. Okay, thank you, Mike. Mike says don't do it. Here's your girlfriend, Abram. What's...
So far, I missed all the point here. Let's see. When,
I don't think it picked up.
It picked up. Apparently, it knocks out Abram. They've done a whiz-bang of a job with this telephone.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You ask them to fix something, they break something else. So now they've broken the telephone. Julie, are you there?
Yeah.
Hey, what's going on?
No, it's his birthday tomorrow. Don't make him do this.
It's a birthday present for him.
Dave's birthday
tomorrow. Well, I was going to give him a birthday present, but not now.
Well, you know.
You know what? I'd get there first.
It's not going to affect her.
All right, Julie. Well, that's the bet that he made, Julie. What can I tell you?
And I've got the cleaning lady coming.
At 7:30.
Yeah.
Oh.
Wow.
Why do we even have these guys even touch these things with a screwdriver?
I don't know.
It never fails.
What
you know?
Did Julie say? I couldn't hear her.
She's all excited for you to have sex with a man.
What? No, she's not.
Yeah.
Dad, do you know what?
No, I don't.
You know what?
Dave, I gotta go. I gotta get out of here.
Radio.
I get out of here.
They've been trying to explain it to you for 15 minutes every direction. The bet was that the loser has to be with another guy in that way.
Wow.
Dave, I don't know about you.
What?
You told me you thought he was gay, Wayne.
No.
You said, oh, I think he's gay.
No.
You did say that in the hallway, Dad. That's what spurned on this whole bet thing.
In the hallway? I was teasing,
you.
Yeah, I was.
You're gay.
Well, Wayne, I got a question for you.
No, okay, I mean, what?
You know what the bet was?
No.
God, I just told you 40, 30 seconds ago, Dad, the loser of yesterday's golf game...
Has to fall in love with a man.
Has to fall in love with a man in a physical way.
You
You know what I mean, Dad?
Is that green?
No, I don't. You got to listen, Dave.
Is that green?
No, it was
the love story.
Love Laura's theme from Dr. Zhivago.
Let me hear it again, bro.
Dad, pitching is...
I'm not sure it goes that way.
Pitch, Dad, and a pitcher and a catcher, Dad, is not baseball terminology. Oh. A pitcher is the guy...
Oh, don't even explain it.
Yeah, standing up, and the catcher's the guy...
I don't think you can do it anyway.
Anyway, Dad.
You don't have to do that.
Do you got it now? Do you have it now?
No, I don't get it. I have a big...
Yeah, you have a vague idea. Okay, all right.
Look at the porcelain thing on the way down to TJ. You'll see it. Two monkeys.
Well, I know David, we,
he's ticked. When he does it, when he calls me David.
Uh-oh. So
well, now, hey, hang on. You haven't heard the best part yet.
The best part?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You didn't hear what the final score was yesterday.
Okay, give me the final score.
94-94
Really?
Tie game.
Really?
I had to make a putt at the end of the game to beat him, and I blew it.
Dad,
oh!
I made a 10-foot putt. I tied him. I don't have to do the bet.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You
two teasers.
Listen, bring the crew up down to help move, because we've got to...
All right, see you later, Wayne. I got to go.
We got to go.
Okay. We got to go.
All right. Hey, Bromo.
Yeah.
How about the same bet next week? Carryover.
No way.
Poor gay Dan. His heart is broken here.
Oh, that's so sad. I know how you feel, man.
Well, gay Dan's all excited because Abramowitz is finally going to surrender to his knees.
Oh, those guys are bad.
I know.
Well, I can tell you that I'm 100% not gay.